25th of July, 1999. The newly restored Flying Scotsman sits outside her home shed amid the railway dereliction of Southall. Getting her back to work has cost £2.25 million. Now she must earn her living. And today she'll take the first of four excursions to Salisbury in Wiltshire. Great care is taken oiling the ex-works Pacific, for it's only 3 weeks since her triumphant inaugural run up the East Coast mainline, though the engineers are confident of Flying Scotsman's reliability.
We did four test runs, you know, in the week beginning June the 21st, and those four runs were, well, first a light one to Didcot, and we did that out at 40 mile an hour and back at 60 mile an hour with one coach. And we didn't stop for 50 miles to check bearing temperatures, etc. And my thoughts were, well, we're pushing our luck a bit, but if we get through it, it's we're on. And we got through it. And the second night, we went to Westbury with 11 coaches on, a trailing load of about 440 tons. And we did most of the journey at 70 mile an hour.
It was a race against time to get Flying Scotsman ready for the rail tour programme. The test runs were done in grey undercoat. But now, with all the finishing touches, Flying Scotsman looks as good as ever. But this is not exactly the same machine that set that world record in New South Wales. Her new owner, Dr. Tony Marchington, has funded a series of improvements that include air braking and much enhanced performance. Flying Scotsman is rumoured to be putting out £40,000 of tractive effort. The reasons include higher boiler pressure, bigger cylinders, and improved steam passages. The double chimney is back as well. Someone's calculated that she pumped out 2,420 horsepower towards the top of Stoke Bank on the way to York. But that was just one trip, and Flying Scotsman's potential remains something of a mystery. Roland Kennington has been advised that Flying Scotsman's grate might be inadequate for the revised front end. Trips like today's will answer that question. But the engineer knows that his locomotive is now under the microscope as far as reliability and performance are concerned. He takes the controls briefly in the yard before handing over to the EWS footplate crew. Among today's passengers will be the owner, a lifelong steam enthusiast.
As a young, very young boy, I was raised by the then LMS, London, Midland Scottish. And to get me out of the way of my mother, my father used to take me down at 3, 4, 5 years old to watch the engine shunting at Gow Hole, which is a big shunting depot north of Chinley on the Midland route. And I suppose from that, I got steam sort of instilled in me, and in my late teens and early 20s I got interested in steam traction engines, and so during the my 20s and 30s collected together a whole collection of steam traction engines, steam showman's engines, ploughing engines, steam rollers, traction engines. I've got a steam tug, and my wife always said, you know, that's fine, sir, but you're never going to get interested in trains, are you? Promise me you'll never get interested in trains. And then in the early 90s, I thought, well, I wouldn't mind a train, a locomotive. And I started looking for a Gresley A4. And of course, the A4s, there are six of them, and I couldn't find one immediately. But this had sort of rekindled my interest in steam locomotives. And then I was coming onto Oxford Station one day, and there was a copy of a railway magazine, and it said, Flying Scotsman for sale, £1.25 million. So I rang up my friend Bill, now Sir William McAlpine, and said, is it true? And he said, yes. We met a few weeks later and I bought it.
If he couldn't have an A4, Tony Marchington would have something in the same performance league.
When I asked Roland Kennington to rebuild it for me, I knew that I had an engineer of exceptional qualities. Roland is an awkward cuss, but my God, is he a good railway engineer. And my instructions to Roland was, I want it rebuilt to perfect working condition. He said, well, do you want to run a main line? And I said, yes. He said, in which case, we can start to think about a few innovations that were not part of the A3 design, or for that matter, part of the A4 design, but are sensible things to do. For example, we went to the double chimney with the cowl chop exhaust, that's obvious. We had new cylinders to fit, so when you're fitting new cylinders, new blocks, why not bore them out and realign them slightly wider than even an A4? The steam feed came out of the superheater body, 5-inch, and went into the valve chest at 7-inch. So why not have that 7-inch all the way through? We know also that Gresley achieved significant improvements by polishing the inside of the valve surfaces. So let's polish the valves, steam passages.
So was Flying Scotsman now in the same league as the Kings, the Duchesses and the A2s in terms of tractive effort? The answer seems to be yes.
I think it's about 40,400 now. And it was when it was first built in 1923, it was only 32,000. With the improvements of that were effected by long travel valves and taking it through to the A3 configuration, it went up to about 33,300. But as I say, it's now 40,400.
Paddington was one of seven London termini used by Flying Scotsman during the year, but this wasn't her best departure. Signalling problems between London and Reading had cost more than 10 minutes by Slough, where at last the crew could get going. The route was out via the Barks and Hants to Westbury, then down the Wyly Valley to Salisbury and back to London via Basingstoke and Reading, with a first water stop booked at Newbury Racecourse. And water stop had taken on a new meaning in one of the summer's worst downpours. They'd only have 10 minutes to top up the tender.
Trouble coming, not us. Coming down, I got signal problems from Paddington to Reading. And as we're a steam engine, we don't get priority. Although we're running short of water. So they let everything else go in front of us. Made us 15 minutes late. But hopefully, we're getting that back now. We're about 5 minutes down now. No, a little bit more. But with the masters at the control, we should get it back.
When Flying Scotsman's safety valves lift, the whole world knows about it. And the Southern Railwaymen were still learning the art of keeping this powerful machine quiet. The driver and fireman, Dave Davis and Chris Greystone from Old Oak Common, and Dennis Donovan from Hither Green, had been gradually amending their technique, but the Scotsman was still bellowing as they strode along the Kennet and Avon Canal.
Thank you.
through Bedwin, round the corner, and up Tavernack. Now we're working this engine on about 20% cut off.
Climbing Savernake, they were actually accelerating, to the astonishment and amusement of the traction inspector, who was demonstrating the art of firing round the corners. But note how the fierce draft sucks the dust and coal off his shovel.
When we stopped at Reading, a passenger got on for Plymouth. A woman. So when she gets off at Westbury, we should get a backhander. And she's probably reported us for picking her up. Oh, there it is, on your left. That's the white horse.
They'd made up time effortlessly and were running a minute or so early as they were looped off towards Westbury Station.
We had this one out last week and we've changed our firing tactics and it's been successful. We've worked out with a light and bright fire and she's crept along with 11 bogies, no trouble whatsoever. In fact, we've been up on position 15, the cut-off 15. Savernake we levelled out today, so if there's any Great Western drivers watching, eat your ass.
I could be facetious and say that Savernake doesn't exist, does it? And we've been over it four times now, and we've done 70 mile an hour at the summit on each run. So it really isn't much of a climb at all. I have to say that, of course, we were taking it the easy way. It's a stiffer climb if you go from Westbury towards London on the up road. But however, we've not had the opportunity to do that yet. But the climb from Westbury up to Ditton Marsh, is it?
Dilton, yeah.
Now that's a different ball game altogether. It's quite a stiff climb and it's quite lengthy.
The long climb south from Westbury, pitching to 1 in 70, was to prove a useful test track for the rebuilt locomotive.
Today was probably the best climb of all. And not because we flew up there, it was the way the locomotive was driven. I was in the coach, I wasn't on the engine, I was in the coach and I just listened to it all the way up, along with another guy, and it was very obvious that it was being driven at around 25% cut-off. And it just been left to find its own level. And in fact, we went over there at about 35 mile an hour.
Thank you. Arriving at Salisbury on time, the Scotsman had won some friends among the crew, who usually prefer a bullid to anything else.
Oh, she's very good. She's brilliant engine now, she is. I mean, I always thought the bullyards were good. The bullyards are good, don't get me wrong. But where we're working on position 20, 25, you'd be out on 30 with a bullyard, what we've just come from. We know, because we've come down here with a bullyard. She'll get over the road, she'll get over the road. But this one has a tendency to level the banks out.
Three weeks earlier, the police had estimated that the best part of 1 million people witnessed Flying Scotsman's run to York. And certainly there were hundreds even at Salisbury, not just middle-aged men, but families and children too. Such is the evergreen appeal of steam, and in particular of Flying Scotsman. There were a few moments now for the traction inspector to sum up the trip so far.
Seven act we levelled out again. We were doing 73, 74 over the top of that, and then down the bank, and we were before time at Westbury. And she steamed beautiful. We changed our tactics today because we were firing to her like a bullied last time, which is plenty under the door, but this time we had a light and bright fire.
The idea is to have a good wedge of fire at the back and very little at the front. I mean, the engine will sort the front out for you. And if you don't start off with the corners made right up, well above the door, but not above the door, you know, where you're putting it in, but well up, then she'll steam well.
I mean, we work a lot on the bullies. They're a good engine, but this one does get over the land. The thing is this, she clears the ground. I mean, Dave pushes her along a little bit, but you saw where the lever was compared with the bullet. I mean, we were up on 15, where the bullet would be out on 25, 30.
They regularly handle the King or Clan line.
Yeah.
This engine will outperform them both. Does that surprise you?
Well, personally, you know, it doesn't surprise me. What I'm surprised about is that hard men who have got many years' service on these things are now beginning to say that. That's surprising me. Because when everybody has a bias, and if a man is brought up on a certain type of engine, then he's always going to favour it. And for a man to make a statement like that, that really indicates something to me.
It must mean a lot to you if they're saying this.
It does, yes, yeah, it does, yeah.
But it was the chimney that Ron Grace had come to see with his wife. This wasn't just any old chimney, it was Ron's personal contribution to Flying Scotsman.
Well, the double chimney you see on the engine today was in my garden for 28 years. I bought it off of British Rail for £7.10 in 1964. And it just proved to see it on an engine back today. Roland made a phone call and said, I understand you've got a double chimney in your garden. Could we borrow it? And that's how it come to be on the engine today.
So which engine did it belong on, Ron, and what do you know about its history?
It was off of 60041, Simon Trout. It spent most of its life at Haymarket in Edinburgh. And, you know, it's just an engine that's been cut up and gone.
The snapshot of Ron's grandchildren is a reminder of how big steam locos are. The family are proud the chimney is now back where it belongs.
It's a great thrill because I haven't seen the grandchildren, you know, with their heads poking out of it playing, and, you know, it's a great thrill.
The engine is cold and watered before ambling back through the city to collect the Pride of the Nation rake of coaches. Contrary to popular belief, Flying Scotsman's owner doesn't have limitless funds to pour into the engine. Initial ticket sales have been disappointing, but it will need to earn its keep, because he's only rich, not mega rich.
By many people's standards I am, but by many other people's standards I'm tiny. There are thousands of people in this country much more wealthy than I am, people with tens and hundreds of millions. This has taken a major proportion of what I actually own. And but my feeling is that somebody had to do it, and it was an important contribution long term to other people's enjoyment. When Bill McAlpine sold it to me, he said, you know, you're the next custodian. And that's all we are, really. I mean, no, I don't feel ever so strongly about the locomotive that I actually physically own it. And technically I do, but I don't think anybody has the right to own something like Flying Scotsman at the end of the day. So what my aim is like, you know, there's a clear lesson with Alan Pegler, who owned the locomotive first of all in the 60s, rescued it from British Rail, but then ended up stranded with it in the United States. There's Bill's example, where despite his best efforts, he still found it prohibitive to run towards the early 90s. I've got to make a mark on this locomotive in a way that I've restored it, but I'm determined to make sure that if Tony Marchington dropped dead tomorrow, the Flying Scotsman could go on running unimpaired. And that needs an organisation, it needs a company, a board of directors, it needs a business model that has its risk balanced against return. It has to be properly capitalised. And now that we've got the locomotive back on the rails, all those things will be addressed in the next few years.
It's time to leave, and there's an air of expectation. The unanswerable question about this new improved Flying Scotsman is whether it would outperform other Pacifics like the A4.
It will be difficult, if not impossible, to actually prove that definitively now. But it certainly has got the potential on paper to be to outperform an A4. But whether it would do it in the very high speed ranges is another matter. It was suggested to me by someone of great standing in the steam world that in fact it was over-cylindered. And he didn't think that the fire grate would keep up with it, because it's only a 42 square foot grate. But that's proven to be untrue.
I think that the amount of money that's been spent on Flying Scotsman and the care that's been taken in the restoration, I think we could give any locomotive now or in the future a run for its money in terms of performance.
The improvement in performance, which is considerable, is down to a number of factors, and it's difficult for me to point to which one has actually made the biggest change. But I suspect it's the change to the superheater header, where in fact there was a 5-inch pipe, there's a 7-inch steam pipe inside the boiler from the dome where the regulator is to the front two plate. And then immediately joining that was the superheater header, which had a 5-inch pipe in it. And so you had a terrific throttling effect of steam at that point. Added to that, the throttling carried on because the 43 elements of the superheater, they only had a 1-inch bore pipe in them. And that's been changed to 1¼ bore.
Having climbed the long hill from Salisbury, Flying Scotsman was running easily through Grakely, and the engineman had got that fire nice and thin and bright.
And that's light and bright, as opposed to a bullet. A bullet would be well up under the door, but it's very difficult to get near it now. All right. Fire the front.
The people on the platform at Andover would never have guessed just how relaxed and light-hearted life on the footplate can be when an engine's running well.
That's our driver with his vest on. His shirt wasn't dry this morning. He's only got the one. Coming from. Did you overflow the tender? I just got through. Look at that, look.
Nothing up there, yeah.
Hardly anything over the front.
Flying Scotsman was back in business. In all the years Roland Kennington has known the engine, it's never failed outside the shed. In the year ahead, it would travel several thousand miles, and only time would tell if Flying Scotsman could maintain its impeccable record.
I've always regarded it as a pretty tolerant machine. It will take abuse in various forms and still perform. What we wanted to produce was a locomotive that was capable of hauling a good-sized train, and by that I mean 500, 550 tonnes, but fast enough to mingle in with HSTs and the modern railway and be able to perform in a way that didn't cause the modern railway embarrassment.
Flying Scotsman was booked to take four trips to Stratford-upon-Avon in the winter. The idea was to send it up the old Great Western main line through Banbury and Warwick. But the route isn't what it was, and this single section north of Bicester proves that there are no straight lines in nature. It was a wild day, a grey day, and for Flying Scotsman it was to be the worst day of the year, and certainly not one to remember.
No, it wasn't. No. We did actually break a string on that day, which proved to cause problems later on, which we were unaware of at the time. And when you're running, you don't know that you've broken a spring necessarily, but certainly it didn't ride so well on the way back.
Worse still, the Midlands engine men would struggle all day to make Flying Scotsman perform. Their problems were to begin north of Warwick with that long climb to Hatton. It's a slog at the best of times, but the big engine was making heavy weather of the 1 in 100 gradient. The power was there, they just couldn't use it.
In fact, that was one of our worst days operationally. We did a great deal of slipping that day, and
I think that perhaps the less said about it on record is the better. But it wasn't a good day.
They were late out of Stratford too, but this was to be their last trip to Paddington for a while. The accident at Ladbroke Grove meant using other routes, and next time they came out via Didcot, turning north towards Oxford, with a winter chill in the air to highlight Flying Scotsman's prodigious output of power, and for once the steam was coming out of the chimney rather than the valves. Around the corner at Wilmcote station, the photographers were gathering for a double dose of Sunday morning steam. Before Scotsman could go into Stratford, Rood Ashton Hall would have to come out, and that meant photo opportunities in both directions. The Birmingham Railway Museum's wonderful Shakespeare Express was a sight for sore eyes. It's uphill in both directions into Wilmcote, but once over the brow, Flying Scotsman could drift downhill all the way into Stratford-upon-Avon. Many of those on board were planning some Christmas shopping. Steam has been a really welcome boost for the town. It was the same in the evening. Rood Ashton Hall went first again. Amazing to see steam expresses to Birmingham and London setting out from an English country town on a Sunday evening in 1999. Flying Scotsman was booked on a trip to Yeovil. The interesting bit was the climb out of Andover from a dead stand with 13 bogies. Roland Kennington had a growing admiration for the professionalism of the Southern engine men. They couldn't necessarily stop a slip, but by God, they were certainly going to try.
The Southern men, particularly, have taken to it very well, and we've very much enjoyed working with them because they have taken the trouble to get to know the machine and treat it the way it's best treated, and therefore they've got the performance.
The experts were still trying to work out which factors had contributed most to Flying Scotsman's newfound performance.
The improved performance is really the result of, mainly the result of, probably three things. One is the increased boiler pressure. Two is the straightening out of the steam pipes. And three is undoubtedly the double chimney and Carl Chap blast, which is probably... on its own done more than the others because it reduces back pressure, and if you reduce the back pressure, which is negative pressure of course, I mean it's if you've got it, you've got to provide work to get rid of it, and that work is not going into hauling the train. Now the reduction of back pressure has been quite tremendous, and I think that with the other two coupled to it is has produced the results we're seeing.
Flying Scotsman was deputising for the failed King Edward I, and ahead lay that fearsome bank east of Sherborne. few miles further on, Scotsman was to be seen blowing off against the injectors at the top of Porton Bank. So far, Flying Scotsman had been running without blinkers. The owner didn't like those German-style smoke deflectors, and in high summer, they didn't matter. But his chief engineer was now itching to get the spanner out, even though opinions are divided about whether they enhance the machine or ruin its appearance.
If you look at the smoke box, the bolts are still in the smoke box there to put them on, so they can be put them on in the morning.
And one day, no doubt, you will.
Well, I have been accused of offering a driver £20 to complain, so I have to put them on. But I think the smoke deflectors enhanced it, because if you take a side view shot of the engine, it is unbalanced with that chimney, because it comes so far forward. If you put the smoke deflectors on, it balances that up.
And guess what Flying Scotsman had for Christmas? British Railways didn't put smoke deflectors on for a joke. They do improve the driver's vision, and in the modern safety-conscious railway atmosphere, that's an unanswerable case. But as for looks, well, it's a matter of taste. Four days after Christmas, this was the perfect place to show off the new-look engine, Honiton Bank. In the foreground, a hedgerow running to the right marks the line of the much-lamented branch line from Seaton Junction. If there was one performance in the year which pleased the Flying Scotsman team most, it was this one.
Delighted with that climb, yes, yeah, because it's a 7 or 8 mile climb, and there's a 20 mile an hour slack at the bottom, permanent speed restriction. We had a load of around 500 tons, and we topped the bank at 44 mile an hour, something like that. I'd just love to go up there again.
On the return working via Taunton, Flying Scotsman was faced with another big climb. This time it was Whitehall.
Thank you.
December the 29th was in fact one of those days when we felt we'd done a bit more than we'd done before. We had a good climb of Honiton Bank. It's the first time we've been up there, or the engine's been up there for 30 years. And on the return journey on the same day, we had a very good run from Exeter through Taunton to Castle Carey in Westbury, where we ran early most of the way and ran at our maximum speed for mile upon mile.
Early in the new year, people might have been surprised to see steam issuing from underneath the main line out of Waterloo, but it was just Flying Scotsman joining from Virginia Water with the Orient Express stock in place of Taw Valley. If an engine's going to slip, it'll do it here, for this is a wicked gradient on a tight curve, and today it's drizzling. Flying Scotsman simply walked away with its heavy load, underlining claims that this is now an engine in the £40,000 tractive effort league. It emerged from Mitchell Dever Tunnel, picking up speed and thrilling the inevitable crowd in the winter's gloom. Its destination was Southampton Docks. The engine had shown absolutely no distress at its load of well over 500 tons.
As you say, it's proving to be a very strong engine, and in fact, we haven't yet come across a situation where the load has been has held us back at all. One of the Southern drivers took us back from Southampton, and he was amazed at how well, with the Bosey train, we climbed the long bank from Eastleigh right up to Basingstoke, and as far as Battledown Junction anyway. And in fact, he claimed that he ran up there at a speed of around 70 miles an hour with a much shorter cut-off than he would have expected to have had to use. And He was quite amazed at his performance, and he was a better judge than I am, because he's done it with other engines and same load with other engines. And as I say, he was amazed that we did it as easily as we did.
The engine was outperforming Clanline, that Rolls-Royce of the steam world, and Flying Scotsman got another chance with the Vosey stock on the Surrey Hills luncheon trip. It's a tootle around the suburbs until the Shalford water stop. After that, things would be different. And this is the tough bit. You can see the gradient. It reaches 1 in 96 later on. These days, the engine has a softer blast and bigger lungs. But is it different in character from the old Flying Scotsman?
Oh, absolutely, yeah. And again, I come back to the double chimney because the firing technique has changed now with the double chimney. As a single chimney engine, it would perform, but you had to be very, very careful how you fired it. And if you put what we call a haystack fire in the middle, you would get no performance out of it. But if you fired it back corners and down the sides and kept it very thin, then you'd get performance. Now, whilst that is still important, it's not quite as critical as it used to be. And it will burn through a thicker fire better than it would because of the increased draft. There's a confliction there because you talk about a double chimney reducing back pressure and having a softer blast. That doesn't mean that it isn't any more fierce on the fire, because it's a lot fiercer on the fire, because you've got twice the area at the front, which is pulling through.
She was certainly steaming on her way to Newton Abbot, but was it coming from the chimney? The occasion was Flying Scotsman's starring visit at the Newton Abbot Transport Festival. Once again, this was Savernake taken by storm.
On the trip to Newton Abbot recently, we had another very good run westbound. And had a very good climb of Wellington Bank. We've had a good climb of Stoke Bank, and we've had a good climb of Honiton Bank. So I think that people can now see that, certainly crews can see, that the engine is capable of performing, and they've had enough trips on it to have got the feel of it.
They were waiting for her at the seaside along that picture postcard coastline of Dawlish, with the jumbled sound of seagulls and shingle, and little boys who've just noticed that Thomas the Tank Engine's big brother is in the distance. Who knows what impact on the minds of today's little children this scene will have. Maybe they too will want to preserve Flying Scotsman. But this wasn't the only steam locomotive about. There was another sound, very much of the West Country. One of Tyesley's panniers was running through Taw Bay to the same event. Flying Scotsman hadn't put a foot wrong all year, but the people who look after her were not being complacent.
We're only as good as our last run, of course, and the next time we go out, if we fail, then that will be the headline. But we've done coming up to 7,000 miles, and we've done it, apart from that bad day at Stratford, we haven't really had a falter. And I just hope we can maintain that.
A year after she first turned a wheel, the rebuilt Flying Scotsman was on preserved metals, gracing Didcot's 2000 event. She was taking it in turns to trundle up and down the demonstration line. The King, happily restored to sparkling condition, was working alongside her. That pannier tank was back again. But as for the star of the show, well, she speaks for herself.
The reduction of back pressure has been quite tremendous, and I think that with the other two coupled to it has produced the results we're seeing. Oh.
Flying Scotsman was deputising for the failed King Edward I, and ahead lay that fearsome bank east of Sherborne. A few miles further on, Scotsman was to be seen blowing off against the injectors at the top of Porton Bank. So far, Flying Scotsman had been running without blinkers. The owner didn't like those German-style smoke deflectors, and in high summer, they didn't matter. But his chief engineer was now itching to get the spanner out, even though opinions are divided about whether they enhance the machine or ruin its appearance.
If you look at the smoke box, the bolts are still in the smoke box there to put them on, so they can be put them on in the morning.
And one day, no doubt, you will.
Well, I have been accused of offering a driver £20 to complain, so I have to put them on. But I think the smoke deflectors enhanced it, because if you take a side view shot of the engine, it is unbalanced with that chimney, because it comes so far forward. If you put the smoke deflectors on, it balances that up.
And guess what Flying Scotsman had for Christmas? British Railways didn't put smoke deflectors on for a joke. They do improve the driver's vision, and in the modern safety-conscious railway atmosphere, that's an unanswerable case. But as for looks, well, it's a matter of taste. Four days after Christmas, this was the perfect place to show off the new-look engine, Honiton Bank. In the foreground, a hedgerow running to the right marks the line of the much-lamented branch line from Seaton Junction. If there was one performance in the year which pleased the Flying Scotsman team most, it was this one.
delighted with that climb, yes, yeah, because it's a 7 or 8 mile climb, and as a 20 mile an hour slack at the bottom, permanent speed restriction, we had a load of around 500 tonnes, and we topped the bank at 44 mile an hour, something like that. I'd just love to go up there again.
On the return working, via Taunton, Flying Scotsman was faced with another big climb. This time, it was Whitebourne.
December the 29th was in fact one of those days when we felt we'd done a bit more than we'd done before. We had a good climb of Honiton Bank. It's the first time we've been up there, or the engine's been up there for 30 years. And on the return journey on the same day, we had a very good run from Exeter through Taunton to Castle Carey in Westbury, where we ran early most of the way. And ran at our maximum speed for mile upon mile.
Early in the new year, people might have been surprised to see steam issuing from underneath the main line out of Waterloo, but it was just Flying Scotsman joining from Virginia Water with the Orient Express stock in place of Taw Valley. If an engine's going to slip, it'll do it here, for this is a wicked gradient on a tight curve, and today it's drizzling. Flying Scotsman simply walked away with its heavy load, underlining claims that this is now an engine in the £40,000 tractive effort league. It emerged from Mitchell Dever Tunnel, picking up speed and thrilling the inevitable crowd in the winter's gloom. Its destination was Southampton Docks. The engine had shown absolutely no distress at its load of well over 500 tons.
As you say, it's proving to be a very strong engine, and in fact, we haven't yet come across a situation where the load has been, has held us back at all. One of the Southern drivers took us back from Southampton, and he was amazed at how well, with the Bosie train, we climbed along bank from Eastleigh right up to Basingstoke, and as far as Battledown Junction anyway. And in fact, he claimed that he ran up there at a speed of around 70 mile an hour with a much shorter cut-off than he would have expected to have had to use. he was quite amazed at his performance, and he was a better judge than I am because he's done it with other engines and same load with other engines. And as I say, he was amazed that we did it as easily as we did.
The engine was outperforming Clanline, that Rolls-Royce of the steam world, and Flying Scotsman got another chance with the Vosey stock on the Surrey Hills luncheon trip. It's a tootle around the suburbs until the Shalford water stop. After that, things would be different. The unanswerable question about this new improved Flying Scotsman is whether it would outperform other Pacifics like the A4.
It will be difficult, if not impossible, to actually prove that definitively now. But it certainly has got the potential on paper to be to outperform an A4. But whether it would do it in the very high speed ranges is another matter, because there is a It was suggested to me by someone of great standing in the steam world that in fact it was over-cylindered, and he didn't think that the fire grate would keep up with it because it's only a 42 square foot grate, but that's proven to be untrue.
I think that the amount of money that's been spent on Flying Scotsman and the care that's been taken in the restoration, I think we could give any locomotive now or in the future a run for its money in terms of performance.
The improvement in performance, which is considerable, is down to a number of factors, and it's difficult for me to point to which one has actually made the biggest change. But I suspect it's the change to the superheater header, where in fact there was a 5-inch pipe, there's a 7-inch steam pipe inside the boiler from the dome where the regulator is to the front two plate. And then immediately joining that was the superheater header, which had a 5-inch pipe in it. And so you had a terrific throttling effect of steam at that point. Added to that, the throttling carried on because the 43 elements of the superheater, they only had a 1-inch bore pipe in them. And that's been changed to 1¼ bore.
Having climbed the long hill from Salisbury, Flying Scotsman was running easily through Greatley, and the engineman had got that fire nice and thin and bright.
And that's light and bright, as opposed to a bullet. A bullet would be well up under the door, but it's very difficult to get near it now. All right.
The people on the platform at Andover would never have guessed just how relaxed and light-hearted life on the footplate can be when an engine's running well.
That's our driver with his vest on. His shirt wasn't dry this morning. He's only got the one. Coming from. Ah, did you overflow the tender? Oh, I just got through. Look at that, look.
Nothing up there, yeah.
Is there? Hardly anything over the front.
Flying Scotsman was back in business. In all the years Roland Kennington has known the engine, it's never failed outside the shed. In the year ahead, it would travel several thousand miles, and only time would tell if Flying Scotsman could maintain its impeccable record.
I've always regarded it as a pretty tolerant machine. It will take abuse in various forms and still perform. What we wanted to produce was a locomotive that was capable of hauling a good-sized train, and by that I mean 500, 550 tonnes, but fast enough to mingle in with HSTs and the modern railway and be able to perform in a way that didn't cause the modern railway embarrassment.
Flying Scotsman was booked to take 4 trips to Stratford-upon-Avon in the winter. The idea was to send it up the old Great Western main line through Banbury and Warwick. But the route isn't what it was, and this single section north of Bicester proves that there are no straight lines in nature. It was a wild day, a grey day, and for Flying Scotsman it was to be the worst day of the year, and certainly not one to remember.
No, it wasn't. No. We did actually break a string on that day, which proved to cause problems later on, which we were unaware of at the time. And when you're running, you don't know that you've broken a spring necessarily, but certainly it didn't ride so well on the way back.
Worse still, the Midlands engine men would struggle all day to make Flying Scotsman perform. Their problems were to begin north of Warwick with that long climb to Hatton. It's a slog at the best of times, but the big engine was making heavy weather of the 1 in 100 gradient. The power was there, they just couldn't use it.
In fact, that was one of our worst days operationally. We did a great deal of slipping that day, and I think that perhaps the less said about it on record is the better. Is the better. But it wasn't a good day.
They were late out of Stratford too, but this was to be their last trip to Paddington for a while. The accident at Ladbroke Grove meant using other routes, and next time they came out via Didcot, turning north towards Oxford, with a winter chill in the air to highlight Flying Scotsman's prodigious output of power, and for once the steam was coming out of the chimney rather than the valves. Round the corner at Wilmcote station, the photographers were gathering for a double dose of Sunday morning steam. Before Scotsman could go into Stratford, Rood Ashton Hall would have to come out, and that meant photo opportunities in both directions. The Birmingham Railway Museum's wonderful Shakespeare Express was a sight for sore eyes. It's uphill in both directions into Wilmcote, but once over the brow, Flying Scotsman could drift downhill all the way into Stratford-upon-Avon. Many of those on board were planning some Christmas shopping. Steam has been a really welcome boost for the town. It was the same in the evening. Rood Ashton Hall went first again. Amazing to see steam expresses to Birmingham and London setting out from an English country town on a Sunday evening in 1999. Flying Scotsman was booked on a trip to Yeovil. The interesting bit was the climb out of Andover from a dead stand with 13 bogies. Roland Kennington had a growing admiration for the professionalism of the Southern engine men. They couldn't necessarily stop a slip, but by God, they were certainly going to try.
Yeah.
the southern men particularly have taken to it very well, and we've very much enjoyed working with them, because they have taken the trouble to get to know the machine and treat it the way it's best treated, and therefore they've got the performance.
The experts were still trying to work out which factors had contributed most to Flying Scotsman's newfound performance.
The improved performance is really the result of, mainly the result of, probably three things. One is the increased boiler pressure. Two is the straightening out of the steam pipes. And three is undoubtedly the double chimney and Carl Chap blast, which is probably on its own done more than the others, because it reduces back pressure. And if you reduce the back pressure, which is negative pressure, of course, I mean, it's if you've got it, you've got to provide work to get rid of it. And that work is not going into hauling the train. Now,
July 25th, 1999. The newly restored Flying Scotsman sits outside her home shed amid the railway dereliction of Southall. Getting her back to work has cost £2.25 million. Now she must earn her living. And today she'll take the first of four excursions to Salisbury in Wiltshire. Great care is taken oiling the ex-works Pacific, for it's only 3 weeks since her triumphant inaugural run up the East Coast mainline, though the engineers are confident of Flying Scotsman's reliability.
We did four test runs, you know, in the week beginning June the 21st, and those four runs were, well, first a light one to Didcot, and we did that out at 40 mile an hour and back at 60 mile an hour with one coach. And we didn't stop for 50 miles to check bearing temperatures, etc. And my thoughts were, well, we're pushing our luck a bit, but if we get through it, it's we're on. And we got through it. And the second night, we went to Westbury with 11 coaches on, a trailing load of about 440 tons. And we did most of the journey at 70 miles an hour.
It was a race against time to get Flying Scotsman ready for the rail tour programme. The test runs were done in grey undercoat. But now, with all the finishing touches, Flying Scotsman looks as good as ever. But this is not exactly the same machine that set that world record in New South Wales. Her new owner, Dr. Tony Marchington, has funded a series of improvements that include air braking and much enhanced performance. Flying Scotsman is rumoured to be putting out 40,000 pounds of tractive effort. The reasons include higher boiler pressure, bigger cylinders, and improved steam passages. The double chimney is back as well. Someone's calculated that she pumped out 2,420 horsepower towards the top of Stoke Bank on the way to York, but that was just one trip, and Flying Scotsman's potential remains something of a mystery. Roland Kennington has been advised that Flying Scotsman's grate might be inadequate for the revised front end. Trips like today's will answer that question. But the engineer knows that his locomotive is now under the microscope as far as reliability and performance are concerned. He takes the controls briefly in the yard before handing over to the EWS footplate crew. Among today's passengers will be the owner, a lifelong steam enthusiast.
As a young, very young boy, I was raised by the then LMS, London, Midland Scottish, and to get me out of the way of my mother, my father used to take me down at 3, 4, 5 years old to watch the engine shunting at Gow Hall, which is a big shunting depot north of Chinley on the Midland route. And I suppose from that, I got steam sort of instilled in me, and in my late teens and early 20s I got interested in steam traction engines, and so during the my 20s and 30s collected together a whole collection of steam traction engines, steam showman's engines, ploughing engines, steam rollers, traction engines. I've got a steam tug, and my wife always said, you know, that's fine, sir, but you're never going to get interested in trains, are you? Promise me you'll never get interested in trains. And then in the early 90s, I thought, well, I wouldn't mind a train, a locomotive. And I started looking for a Gresley A4. And of course, the A4s, there are 6 of them, and I couldn't find one immediately. But this had sort of rekindled my interest in steam locomotives. And then I was coming onto Oxford Station one day, and there was a copy of a railway magazine, and it said, Flying Scotsman's for sale, 1.25 million. So I rang up my friend, Bill, now Sir William McAlpine, and said, is it true? And he said, yes. We met a few weeks later and I bought it.
If he couldn't have an A4, Tony Marchington would have something in the same performance league.
When I asked Roland Kennington to rebuild it for me, I knew that I had an engineer of exceptional qualities. Roland is an awkward cuss, but my God, is he a good railway engineer. And my instructions to Roland was, I want it rebuilt to perfect working condition. He said, well, do you want to run a main line? And I said, yes. He said, in which case, we can start to think about a few innovations that were not part of the A3 design, or for that matter, part of the A4 design, but are sensible things to do. For example, we went to the double chimney with the cowl chop exhaust, that's obvious. We had new cylinders to fit, so when you're fitting new cylinders, new blocks, why not bore them out and reline them slightly wider than even an A4? The steam feed came out of the superheater body, 5-inch, and went into the valve chest at 7-inch. So why not have that 7-inch all the way through? We know also that Gresley achieved significant improvements by polishing the inside of the valve surfaces. So let's polish the valves, steam passages.
So was Flying Scotsman now in the same league as the Kings, the Duchesses and the A2s in terms of tractive effort? The answer seems to be yes.
I think it's about 40,400 now, and it was when it was first built in 1923, it was only 32,000. With the improvements of that were effected by long travel valves and taking it through to the A3 configuration, it went up to about 33,300, but as I say, it's now 40,400.
Paddington was one of seven London termini used by Flying Scotsman during the year, but this wasn't her best departure. Signalling problems between London and Reading had cost more than 10 minutes by Slough, where, at last, the crew could get going. The route was out via the Barks and Hants to Westbury, then down the Wyly Valley to Salisbury and back to London via Basingstoke and Reading, with a first water stop booked at Newbury Racecourse. And water stop had taken on a new meaning in one of the summer's worst downpours. They'd only have 10 minutes to top up the tender.
Trouble coming, not us. Coming down, I got signal problems from Paddington to Reading. And as we're a steam engine, we don't get priority. Although we're running short of water. So they let everything else go in front of us. Made us 15 minutes late. But hopefully, we're getting that back now. We're about 5 minutes down now. No, a little bit more. But with the masters at the control, we should get it back.
When Flying Scotsman's safety valves lift, the whole world knows about it. And the Southern Railwaymen were still learning the art of keeping this powerful machine quiet. The driver and fireman, Dave Davis and Chris Greystone from Old Oak Common, and Dennis Donovan from Hither Green, had been gradually amending their technique, but the Scotsman was still bellowing as they strode along the Kennet and Avon Canal. Climbing Savernake, they were actually accelerating to the astonishment and amusement of the traction inspector, who was demonstrating the art of firing round the corners. But note how the fierce draft sucks the dust and coal off his shovel.
When we stopped at Reading, a passenger got on for Plymouth. A woman. So when she gets off at Westbury, we should get a backhander. They're calling reporters for picking her up. Oh, there it is, on your left. That's the White Horse.
They'd made up time effortlessly and were running a minute or so early as they were looped off towards Westbury Station.
We had this one out last week and we've changed our firing tactics and it's been successful. We've worked out with a light and bright fire and she's crept along with 11 bogies, no trouble whatsoever. In fact, we've been up on position 15, the cut-off 15. seven actually levelled out today, so if there's any Great Western drivers watching, eat your ass.
I could be facetious and say that Savernac doesn't exist, does it? And we've been over it four times now, and we've done 70 mile an hour at the summit on each run. So it really isn't much of a climb at all. I have to say that, of course, we were taking it the easy way. It's a stiffer climb if you go from Westbury towards London on the up road. But however, we've not had the opportunity to do that yet. But the climb from Westbury up to Ditton Marsh, is it?
Dilton, yeah.
Now that's a different ball game altogether. It's quite a stiff climb and it's quite lengthy.
The long climb south from Westbury, pitching to 1 in 70, was to prove a useful test track for the rebuilt locomotive.
Today was probably the best climb of all. And not because we flew up there, it was the way the locomotive was driven. I was in the coach, I wasn't on the engine, I was in the coach and I just listened to it all the way up, along with another guy, and it was very obvious that it was being driven at around 25% cutoff. And it just been left to find its own level. And in fact, we went over there at about 35 mile an hour.
Arriving at Salisbury on time, the Scotsman had won some friends among the crew, who usually prefer a bullet to anything else.
Oh, she's very good. She's brilliant engine now, she is. I always thought the bullets were good. The bullets are good, don't get me wrong. But where we're working on position 20, 25, you'd be out on 30 with a bullet, what we've just come down. We know, because we've come down there with a bullet. She'll get over the road, she'll get over the road. But this one has a tendency to level the banks out.
Three weeks earlier, The police had estimated that the best part of 1 million people witnessed Flying Scotsman's run to York. And certainly there were hundreds even at Salisbury, not just middle-aged men, but families and children too. Such is the evergreen appeal of steam, and in particular of Flying Scotsman. There were a few moments now for the traction inspector to sum up the trip so far.
7 act we levelled out again. We were doing 73, 74 over the top of that, and then down the bank, and we were before time at Westbury. And she steamed beautiful. We changed our tactics today because we were firing to her like a bullion last time, which is plenty under the door. But this time we had a light and bright fire.
The idea is to have a good wedge of fire at the back and very little at the front. I mean, the engine will sort the front out for you. And if you don't start off with the corners made right up, above, well above the door, but not above the door, you know, where you're putting it in, but well up, then she'll steam well.
I mean, we work a lot on the bullies. They're a good engine, but this one does get over the land. The thing is this, she clears the ground. I mean, Dave pushes her along a little bit, but you saw where the lever was compared with the bullet. I mean, we were up on 15, where the bullet would be out on 25, 30.
They regularly handle the King or Clan line.
Yes.
This engine will outperform them both. Does that surprise you?
Well, personally, you know, it doesn't surprise me. What I'm surprised about is that hard men who have got many years' service on these things are now beginning to say that. That's surprising me. Because when everybody has a bias, and if a man is brought up on a certain type of engine, then he's always going to favour it. And for a man to make a statement like that, that really indicates something to me.
It must mean a lot to you if they're saying this.
It does, yes, yeah, it does, yeah.
But it was the chimney that Ron Grace had come to see with his wife. This wasn't just any old chimney. It was Ron's personal contribution to Flying Scotsman.
Well, the double chimney you see on the engine today was in my garden for 28 years. I bought it off of British Rail for £7.10 in 1964. And it just proud to see it on an engine back today. Roland made a phone call and said, I understand you've got a double chimney in your garden. Could we borrow it? And that's how it come to be on the engine today.
So which engine did it belong on, Ron, and what do you know about its history?
It was off of 60041 Simon Trout. It spent most of its life at Haymarket in Edinburgh. And, you know, it's just an engine that's been cut up and gone.
The snapshot of Ron's grandchildren is a reminder of how big steam locos are. The family are proud the chimney is now back where it belongs.
It's a great thrill because I haven't seen the grandchildren, you know, with their heads poking out of it playing, and, you know, it's a great thrill.
The engine is cold and watered before ambling back through the city to collect the Pride of the Nation rake of coaches. Contrary to popular belief, Flying Scotsman's owner doesn't have limitless funds to pour into the engine. Initial ticket sales have been disappointing, but it will need to earn its keep because he's only rich, not mega rich.
By many people's standards I am, but by many other people's standards I'm tiny. There are thousands of people in this country much more wealthy than I am, people with tens and hundreds of millions. This has taken a major portion of what I actually own, and but my feeling is that somebody had to do it, and it was an important contribution long term to other people's enjoyment. When Bill McAlpine sold it to me, he said, you know, you're the next custodian. And that's all we are, really. I mean, no, I don't feel ever so strongly about the locomotive that I actually physically own it. And technically I do, but I don't think anybody has a right to own something like Flying Scotsman at the end of the day. So what my aim is like, you know, there's a clear lesson with Alan Pegler, who owned the locomotive first of all in the 60s, rescued it from British Rail, but then ended up stranded with it in the United States. There's Bill's example, where despite his best efforts, he still found it prohibitive to run towards the early 90s. I've got to make a mark on this locomotive in a way that I've restored it, but I'm determined to make sure that if Tony Marchington dropped dead tomorrow, the Flying Scotsman could go on running unimpaired. And that needs an organisation, it needs a company, a board of directors, it needs a business model that has its risk balanced against return. It has to be properly capitalised. And now that we've got the locomotive back on the rails, all those things will be addressed in the next few years.
It's time to leave, and there's an air of expectation.